comparing the protagonists of the two trilogies reveals a lot. Both of the Skywalker boys begin in something close to destitution, with absent fathers in a desert. And yet they're quite different, right off the bat even. Luke pines for adventure, but Anakin just pines for freedom. Yeah, sure, both of them dream of leaving Tatooine and exploring the galaxy, but Luke isn't sentimental about ditching his family. He can't wait to leave. He has far more love for his friends, for Biggs and Wedge, who have already left him behind. Anakin, on the other hand, is defined entirely by his love for his family, which consists of just one single person, his mother. Luke and Anakin aren't different from each other just for the sake of being different. They do share some things. When the call to adventure comes, both boys refuse it. Luke says,
"I can't get involved. I've got work to do."
He's programmed out of a sense of loyalty, not love. He's programmed to obey his mentors. In the first film, he obeys Obi-Wan. In the second film, he disobeys him. And in the third film, he somehow both obeys and disobeys him. He synthesizes the two options. He transcends. Anakin refuses his call to adventure for a very different reason, because he would have to leave his mother behind. Anakin is given a choice. He can remain a slave on this dumpster planet, or he can have his freedom to go explore the stars with his crush and study the Force with one of the greatest Jedi Knights in the history of the game. And he chooses to remain a slave. Just like Luke, Anakin's greatest power, his heart, his ability to love, is the founding flaw of his arc. I think it's crucial to point out how, at the end of A New Hope, Luke must turn off a targeting computer, which is a great metaphor for his conscious mind, while on the other hand, Anakin must turn off the autopilot, which is a great metaphor for just the opposite, his instincts. People who hate The Phantom Menace still tend to love the duel with Darth Maul at the climax. Part of the reason is how cool Darth Maul is and his double-bladed lightsaber and everything. Yeah, that's cool. But that's just the festoons. That's the decor. The reason this lands so hard is because the stakes are emotionally significant.
What's at stake is really how Anakin's going to turn out. Because Qui-Gon is different than the rest of the Jedi. And you get that in the movie. And Qui-Gon is fighting because he knows he's the father that Anakin needs.
Again, just like Episode 6, this lightsaber duel has no causal connection to the two other planes where the war is being fought. This is a spiritual battle. It's a battle for the fate of the Chosen One. It's a fight for the moral alignment of what will become the strongest Jedi in the history of the galaxy, and thus it's a fight for the soul of the galaxy. Qui-Gon Jinn only appears in this one episode, and yet his death is just as tragic as Obi-Wan's or as Yoda's. As we've mentioned before, George Lucas can condense his world-building into a few quick seconds of dialogue, but with Qui-Gon Jinn, he doesn't even need to. He never spells it out for us, but if you're paying attention, it's clear. Qui-Gon Jinn is the OG Jedi. He's also the OG Rebel. I mean, he refused to become a part of the Jedi Council. He just does his own thing. By contrast, Obi-Wan is a company man.
"We will do exactly as the Council has instructed."
His allegiance is not to the Force.
"My allegiance is to the Republic, to democracy!"
He tells his own mentor,
"Do not defy the Council Master, not again."
"I shall do what I must, Obi-Wan."
He tells his own mentor what to do. And what is Qui-Gon Jinn's reaction to tell him to shut up and know his place?
"And you will learn your place, young one."
No, he puts his arm around him. Qui-Gon Jinn was the first Jedi to learn how to return from beyond the grave as a Force ghost. And he even trained Master Yoda how to do this. He is Yoda's master. He is the ultimate Jedi. He discovered the Chosen One. He saved the Chosen One from slavery. He loved the Chosen One. He was destined to be his father. And he dies before he has the chance. This moment always gets me. You have to remember, Obi-Wan is a teenager. He's a Padawan. He hasn't even faced his trials yet. He's not even a full Jedi Knight. And this terrifying, inhuman creature, the first Sith to be seen in 1,000 years, murdered the OG Jedi, Obi-Wan doesn't stand a chance. And yet... even when Maul has the high ground, the Force is with him. Maul is blinded by pride, by emotion. He thought he'd already won the fight. He was unwise to lower his defenses. Obi-Wan's victory over Maul ensures that Anakin will be trained as a Jedi, not a Sith. But Qui-Gon's death is a massive blow, one which has consequences that shape Anakin's life and will one day have a huge impact on the economy of the entire galaxy. The Chosen One has no mentor. He has no father. Obi-Wan is not a father.
You are my brother, Anakin!
He's a brother. I mean, even Luke had a myth about his father that he could cling to. He mentions his father several times. It's something that motivates him to become a Jedi in the first place.
I want to learn the ways of the Force and become a Jedi like my father.
But Anakin doesn't even have that. He has Obi-Wan, a guy who gives him questionable advice.
Dreams pass in time.
A guy who colludes with a fairly corrupt political establishment called the Jedi Order, which, remember, Qui-Gon Jinn was deeply skeptical of. Look, maybe you don't think it's that important to have a father, real or mythological, and I get that. I think all that George Lucas is pointing out in these prequel films is that without strong mentorship, without a wise teacher who loves and understands us and who nurtures a rebellious spirit, there will always be a gap where insidious influences can creep in. Thus, you can see Episode 1 as a film about mentorship. It claims good mentorship is a symbiosis.
You and the Naboo form a symbiont circle.
And we are symbionts with them.
Symbionts?
And bad mentorship is like slavery.
Yes, my master.
Full of covert and overt manipulation. It suggests that mentorship is not unlike fatherhood. It requires paternal authority.
Hey, wait for me!
Anakin, stay where you are. You'll be safe there.
But I...
Stay in that cockpit.
While also suggesting that good mentors reward their mentees and love them.
You should be very proud of your son. He gives without any thought of reward.
And are loved in return. It suggests mentorship, like fatherhood, is really hard, and some people fall into it before they're ready. And like fatherhood, it's a huge responsibility that can shape a person, and thus shape the universe. It suggests that we all rebel against our fathers, and if your father is himself a rebel, like Qui-Gon Jinn, then maybe you'll become a loyalist, like Obi-Wan. And if your mentor is a loyalist, like Obi-Wan, then maybe you'll become an imperialist, like Darth Vader. So let's think about how Anakin's arc in Episode 1 relates to that theme. When we first meet Anakin, he's a very willful boy. He is willing to openly disobey his mother while breaking Watto's rules behind his back in order to do what's right, to help those he loves. Right away, he disobeys rules in order to follow his heart. His mother hates it, but Qui-Gon Jinn loves Anakin for it. He sees the spark in him, he respects him. And Anakin returns that respect with obedience, or he tries to at least. In the climax of Episode 1, Anakin does his best to be obedient to Qui-Gon.
Go back? Qui-Gon told me to stay in this cockpit, so that's what I'm gonna do.
Anakin, who begins rebellious, consciously wants to obey. He obeys, but as if by a technicality or a loophole, he disobeys at the same time. He's literally on autopilot when he rebels.
We gotta do something, R2!
Anakin's autopilot is following his instincts, following his heart. In a sense, this is a reversal of Luke's arc in Episode 4. Luke turning off the targeting computer represents him turning off his conscious mind and becoming intuitive. When Anakin turns off the autopilot, by contrast...
Get us off this autopilot! It's gonna get us both killed!
He's trying to rely on his conscious mind to be less bumbling, instinctual, to think and not to feel. He has to fight to become conscious, and yet, ironically, it's through this effort to become more conscious and less bumbling that he accidentally saves the day, just like Jar Jar, whose clumsiness becomes a boon for him in the climax. Anakin's own clumsiness,
Miss Clumsy,
is his road to victory.
Now this is pod racing.
In Attack of the Clones, Anakin and Obi-Wan work well together when they're buddies, brothers, equals. They clash whenever Obi-Wan attempts to assert dominance. Obi-Wan has not earned Anakin's respect as Qui-Gon did, and thus the ground is fertile for his disobedience. Anakin is told that his great superpower, his heart, is a weakness. He's told not to listen to his emotions. He's told to obey. Just as Empire Strikes Back was the antithesis of A New Hope, Attack of the Clones is the antithesis of The Phantom Menace. However, the prequel trilogy as a whole is the antithesis to the original trilogy. Thus, Attack of the Clones is a sort of reversal of a reversal. It's a very topsy-turvy movie where everything gets confused. Anakin's disobedience begins in earnest in this film, when faced with a choice to either follow his heart and save his mother, or obey his commands and stay with Padme.
I know I'm disobeying my mandate to protect you, Senator, but I have to go. I have to help her.
I'll go with you.
He finds a loophole and manages to do both at the same time. But once he gives an inch, he can't help but take a mile. Acting on autopilot, he butchers an entire village of Tusken Raiders. And please do not use the racial slur sand people. They're called Tusken Raiders. If anyone ever claims that the prequel trilogy has bad acting in it, or that Hayden Christensen is anything but an amazing actor,
what's wrong, Annie?
Show them this scene.
I killed them. I killed them all. They're dead. Every single one of them. And not just the men, but the women and the children too. They're like animals. And I slaughtered them like animals. I hate them!
Imagine asking an actor to grieve for their dead mother, while also sublimating that grief into a hatred directed at a racial other, while also turning that hatred into a performance that is designed to elicit sympathy and love from someone you're pining for. That is a very hard cocktail of emotions to play. George asked a lot of Hayden, and Hayden delivered. This is a jaw-dropping performance. One thing I often hear about Attack of the Clones is that the love story between Anakin and Padme doesn't really make sense. I mean, Anakin's kind of a pathetic simp, and Padme's this, you know, badass politician lady. Why would she fall for him? I have two answers for that. One is, in this scene, you can see it happen. The moment that Padme falls for him is the moment that she realizes the depth of his emotion. When Padme realizes that Anakin is willing to butcher a village of people, she's wondering what he's willing to do for her. She sees the intensity, and she's scared and enthralled by it. The second explanation is that there's something going on in the background here, which is that dark forces are manipulating Padme, and I believe that this is visually expressed by the costume she wears. This costume is also a great bit of visual foreshadowing, which I think explains why George Lucas designed it himself.
There's one costume that George designed himself.
There's a great moment when Padme falls off the helicopter thing, and Anakin shouts, "We have to go back." It takes Obi-Wan some serious effort to get the kid to chill out and listen to reason. This is the return of the repressed. Anakin's emotions, which the Jedi see as a problem and have been bottling up, grow and grow until Anakin has very little room left for his conscious mind, his senses, to take over. Since this is a reversal of a reversal, The conclusion to Anakin's arc in Attack of the Clones is identical to the conclusion of Luke's arc in Empire Strikes Back. Both of them rush in without a plan. Both of them are led by instinct. Both of them lose a hand as a result. This is the first moment that Anakin's disobedience becomes direct and open.
We'll take him together. You're going slowly on the left.
We're taking him now!
No, Anakin, no!
Unlike Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon, who fought Maul together for the most part, Obi-Wan and Anakin never fight Dooku together. Anakin and Obi-Wan can't get on the same page. Anakin can't even try to obey Obi-Wan as he tried to obey Qui-Gon. The difference between Luke and Anakin is that Anakin does not see the error of his ways. Instead, he chooses to simply push his emotions further down into the shadows. Anakin is married to his flaw. There's no turning back. He is now fully disobedient, but keeps it a secret. At the beginning of episode 3, just like the beginning of episode 6, we learn how much Anakin has grown since the last film.
I say patience.
Patience.
Ironically, Anakin is the teacher here. He's the mentor.
Let's be fair, today you are the hero.
And he's literally becoming a father. And yet he's still treated as a child. He's treated as a child by everyone except one person. Anakin is forced to choose between two mentors, and thus between the political and the spiritual.
Why are you asking this of me?
The council is asking you. Let me help you to know the subtleties of the Force.
A choice between the heart and the mind. Anakin, unlike Luke, is not wise enough to transcend this either-or. He cannot synthesize the two options, and as a result, he fails. At the midpoint of episode 6, Luke gains self-awareness, and he knows what the right thing is. At the midpoint of episode 3, Anakin gains self-awareness.
What have I done?
And yet, he still does what is wrong. He turns to the dark side because Palpatine offers him the one thing he wants.
Know the power of the dark side. Power to save Padme.
Love. Family. He doesn't join the dark side for political reasons, he joins the dark side for emotional reasons. Unlike Luke in episode 6, Anakin does not find balance. But like Luke, Anakin does rebel against his mentors and against his own path of least resistance. Anakin's arc shows us how rebellion is not a good thing in and of itself. That sometimes disobedience can have monstrous consequences. Ironically, of course, Anakin's total embrace of his emotions, of sentimentality, eventually leads him to a complete dearth of any desire, of any emotion.
He's more machine now than man, twisted and evil.
The moment when Anakin turns to the dark side, I believe it, because we've had 2.5 films leading up to this moment, showing us how easily Anakin can be swayed by emotion, showing us how much he wants to disobey. In the end, Luke succeeds where his father failed, but paradoxically, it's Anakin's failure which laid the groundwork for his greater victory. Anakin's turn to the dark side comes at the moment that Palpatine electrocutes himself. He was spurred by sympathy. Anakin's turn back to the light comes at the moment that Luke is electrocuted. In some ways, Anakin never changes. And that's exactly why he changes.
I became progressively obsessed with the finale to Revenge of the Sith. And I'm telling you, this finale, it's unbelievable. It takes place on the volcano planet of Mustafar. And in what I was researching, I was just amazed by what it took them like 10 months, you know, to make this model and then raise it up on a giant platform to tip it, pump system, to have the lava flowing. How tepid contemporary art seemed compared to the passionate quality of this finale with this huge musical score. And you're getting this tremendous duel that's like dance theater, the longest duel ever filmed. This is contemporary dance, all right? And okay, so you get this music and the passionate emotion, the two love hate between these two men. Okay, the whole thing's like a Puccini opera. And then so you have this like huge, like it's like romantic nature painting, apocalyptic landscape of the lava. All right, and then and you get this theme that the cross cut, Lucas cross cuts. There's a destruction of the Senate chamber going on the planet of Coruscant. Okay, so you get this theme of the destruction of politics going on at the same moment, and you have the destruction of industry going on, because as these two guys are wrestling around, they like throw off the whole control panels, okay, and the whole industrial complex of the planet of Mustafar starts degenerating. You get these girders. In the lava, like this. All right, and then, okay, the revelation after 30 years, how did Darth Vader get born? Who is Darth Vader? How did he end up be Robot Man? How did that happen? Okay, he loses his arms and his legs, then he catches on fire from the volcano, he incinerates, all these horrors, and so on. And then finally, his broken body is taken, with surgical droids putting him together, okay? Like a Frankenstein monster thing, cross-cutting to Natalie Portman dying in childbirth, and then after all these horrors, okay, incredible control, unbelievable control of tone, all right? The Luke and Leia are separated because no one knows they exist, okay? Separated, and they're taken to distant planets, and one is a beautiful planet based on Switzerland, okay, with footage of Switzerland, with like mountains and valleys, you know, and the other one is a desert planet was Tatooine with its double suns and so on. And so you get this amazing thing, strong men arriving with baby handed off to other strong man sitting with wife, okay, against the great landscape, okay. It is so beautiful, okay. I think that, first of all, that is extremely progressive, okay, to end with this idea of its tenderness of men, okay, toward babies, okay, not just children, but toward babies. And it ends with so absolutely gorgeous. I'm saying, my God, okay, nothing has been produced, I'm serious, nothing in the last 30 years in any of the arts that has been produced as emotionally compelling and significant as the finale of Revenge of the Sith.
So, go ahead and say that these films are cheesy pop culture, that they're kids' movies about space wizards or whatever the hell you want to call them. You can say the same thing about The Tempest, The Iliad, or about Gilgamesh. I mean, the origins of literature are in kids' movies about space wizards. Epic fantasy is the root of the tree of literature. A better critique of these films would be, this is a commercial product of the culture industry, and that would be impossible to argue with because it's true. And yet, they're also metaphysically rich works of art with a dense weave of themes and motifs that rewards deep thinking and multiple viewings. Inheriting such a franchise, being asked to write the next chapter in such a rigorous and mythologically informed saga, is an intimidating task, to say the least. In a sense, those responsible were set up to fail, and therefore, I don't blame anyone for fumbling that pass.